good evening, everyone, and welcome to Doomsday Central. You're listening to Q-Files, and this is a live broadcast. You've all, by now, I'm sure, heard about the attack that supposedly is planned on the L.A. shopping mall. The big question is the powers that be, the New World Order crowd, trying to initiate the same type of events that different places in the world, specifically most currently, Spain has, what you'd say, undergone the terrorist attack that influenced their election. But let me read this, then we're going to talk about it tonight. Federal officials have warned that the Los Angeles Police Department about an unspecified potential threat to a Los Angeles area mall and said an attack may have been planned for today. As of now, the information is uncorroborated and the credibility of the source is unknown, the police department said in a statement. No specific shopping mall was named, but the warning indicated a mall near the federal building in West Los Angeles could be targeted. Ladies and gentlemen, that is the West L.A. Mall, and the bottom line is you can't get any more specific than that. But let's go on. Los Angeles police will increase patrols at shopping malls in the city and ask mall operators to beef up their security while a joint terrorism task force investigates. There's a lesson in futility. The department said it would have no further comment beyond the statement issued late Wednesday. Mayor James Hahn also received the information Wednesday. It's uncorroborated, but we are asking all Los Angeles residents to go on with their daily lives while remaining vigilant and alert. FBI spokesman Matt McLaughlin said the source of the information was of undetermined reliability. Quote, this particular threat, just because of the nature of it, had a little more information, albeit unsubstantiated information. That doesn't necessarily make it really distinctly different from some of these other threats we've heard, he said. He said authorities are obliged to aggressively investigate all threats they can't immediately dismiss. You have to make the public aware of certain dates, locations, threats that you are aware of, he said. Governor Arnold Schwarzenegger has been appraised of the warning, according to a spokeswoman. Several areas in and around Los Angeles have been said to be potential targets for terrorists, including movie studios, bridges, ports, and the Los Angeles International Airport. And add to that, today, as you're probably aware, everyone, that there was an incident at one of the docks in California when a propane, supposedly a shipping container full of propane tanks, exploded, and the dock workers closed down the docks and pretty much got their guys out of harm's way. But the coordination of the timing of these things, I think, is pretty fascinating when you come to the point that, again, if it is an effective means to influence elections, I would suggest that obviously this fight for the White House is going to be different than any other race that we've seen to date. Now, as most of you know, Dick Cheney and President Bush testified together before a closed-door session of the 9/11 Commission. Now, I want to read something that Christopher sent me, and I think Christopher's got it right nailed from the top. He said, Steve, this morning at about 5 a.m. I happened to catch a news blip on the radio, and I hope I heard it wrong, but don't think so. Now, here's what he says. The National Guard was going to be removed from protecting the security of the Golden Gate Bridge because it was deemed no longer economically feasible to keep them there. And then Christopher says, in whose opinion? We have troops spread into 121 and counting countries on this planet, but it's no longer economically feasible to protect our own. I have a really bad feeling that we're being set up big time. Amen. Also, what's the deal for this closed-door, blacked-out 9/11 Commission meeting with Bush and Cheney? Who's working for who here? Are not these Capitol Hill fat cats being funded by our taxes, by your taxes and mine? Is no one in government accountable to the people for anything anymore? Absolutely not. Notice how Bush and Cheney were interviewed together. This wouldn't be to keep their story straight, would it? Well, I don't know this for fact. No one in that room on either side of the table lost their lives in 9/11. That was guaranteed. So, your thoughts tonight, everyone, on the fact that if you want to get to the heart of the matter and two people are involved, you always interrogate or question them separate and apart from each other to see if there are any obvious discrepancies between their testimony. But again, it's an important issue to bring out for everyone's consideration that putting these two guys together, when they're the both two, in my knowledge and talking to multiple military personnel and guys who work for Strategic Air Command, there's only two people in the country that could have caused the F-16s to stand down that day. And if Bush was temporarily out of Washington reading school children stories, then that leaves Dick Cheney. So again, it's amazing to me that you could take all this hearing crap, and that's what it is, crap, and sum it up in saying it's nothing more than another stage play. I honestly believe that the issue is going to not go away. I say that because, again, God in His eternal wisdom and in His historic intervention has always shown people the duplicity of the leaders, the rulers, the kings, the double dealing. Even if He had to give it to a prophet who would be told the things in the night that the plotters and schemers did in the daytime. And so we're talking now about a fascinating set of circumstances wherein this country no longer has the truth, no longer believes the truth, whether it's saying the Pledge of Allegiance like what one congressman took out under God. Well, let me share this with you. It would be more, how should I say this, acceptable if these guys would just admit, I wish it would just come out, and maybe then everybody would believe it, but just say, look, we are absolutely devil-worshipping Luciferians, and we don't believe in God, and we're in control of the country. Now, you think that's far-fetched for me to even suggest that. I suggest to you that day will come, and basically they'll probably end it with tough. Now, fascinating events took place today that during the 9/11 commission hearing, both Bob Kerry and Lee Hamilton left in the middle of the Bush-Cheney testimony, citing prior commitments. Now, let me just share this with you. They knew the timing of the commission. They knew the time that the president would be testifying along with the vice president. Do you think it's pretty interesting that the two, I believe, top-ranking Democrats in this commission would walk out? Now, why did they walk out? Well, obviously, I believe it wasn't because they had prior commitments. That's horse manure. And I got to tell you something. When it smells like it, when it mushes like it, when it looks like it, when you see a pasture full of horses, chances are that's what it is. In this case, we're dealing with probably the southern end of horses, but needless to say, that's why there's so much horse manure. What a metaphor. Now, Drudge is reporting tonight, everyone, that quite candidly, they both just cited previous commitments and walked out. Now, let me ask you this. Do you think that everybody's blind to what really is going on, or do you think that some of these guys do have a clue, and it doesn't matter in this case whether they're Democrats or Republicans? Let me share this. If you take a coin out of your pocket, there's two sides to that coin, but it's one coin. And so it doesn't matter if we get Bonesman A or Bonesman B, we get the bones. And them leg bones. Now, we're at this nexus. We're at a crisis period in this country. And again, all this is basically dance lessons on the Titanic. Ladies and gentlemen, there is no sanity. I suggest to you, no sanity. There is no love for the truth. Quite opposite, there's avoidance of the truth. Hollywood is not doing its greatest screenplays on the cinema, but in the political realm. You've got a total world view now of the United States that is so hostile against the United States that you couldn't have designed it better than it has been playing out. So now we've got a fascinating series of events where concurrent with all this nonsense that the 9/11 Commission, look, when you've got, and this is a really, I'm not making this name up, when you've got people like Gorelick testifying and being one of the main commissioners, and people with, I would say there's dubious backgrounds and very shady relationships, and they won't resign from the commission, you really think there's any truth that's going to come out of this? Or is it just, again, is it just scene one to be followed by scene two, scene three, and scene four? Now, ladies and gentlemen, again, we're talking about some fascinating events taking place that are happening so quickly and so abruptly that it brings me to the next story I want to cover. Now, this story is interesting to me because it's more than just rah-rah. And I'm going to read a bunch of posts on a website that are talking about the mystery trains that are getting more mysterious. Now, it's fascinating because I live in Bozeman, Montana. And Montana, just so you know, Montana has a lot of secret stuff in it. We've got the major missile bases up in Great Falls, but that's not what I'm talking about. I'm talking about very specific hidden bases. magnetic levitated trains, if you will, two trains that run between the bases here and actually go into Nevada and other states. But let me read this, because this is by some guy called Anonymous Coward. Well, at least he admits he's a coward. Listen to this. Since 9/11, a trend has become visible in central Montana. Trains escorted by helicopter gunships in the middle of the night. Short trains, a few cars, usually passenger, and very well lit up, with choppers using searchlights during the escort. Between 3 a.m. and 7, or I'm sorry, excuse me, between 3 and 7 a month have been observed, and the round symbol of FEMA identified some of them. They're always heading northbound, and the choppers peel off at the center of dense population. The trains never stop during those periods and seem to always have clear track to highball through them. Though we have used ham relays to try to follow them to a final destination, they seem to vanish too quickly. Tonight the protocol changed, and three trains have passed in the last hour between 9 and 10 Mountain Standard Time. This was posted, about 2 weeks ago, and this is the first I've heard of it. It says this, where they were sighted, reports were of all three trains being totally unlit, not even a headlamp or a Mars light, and escorted by five gunships each, also unlit. Pilots and engineers must be using starlight technology. By the way, any of people in Bozeman who are listening to me, or anybody in Montana who's listening, if you've got starlight night vision binoculars, anybody using those, well, you'll see the green glow. So my guess is if they're running dark, obviously they're running under a night vision protocol. Now, this is fascinating to me because, again, this is going right through Bozeman, Montana. Now, listen, this bodes for trouble no matter what it means. Today, Bush signed the SARS Forced Quarantine Executive Order, giving police the power to arrest and detain anyone without warrant if they exhibit the flu-like symptoms of SARS. Now, how many of you knew about that? Again, I must have missed that. The SARS Forced Quarantine Executive Order? It looks like the perfect prelude to a national medical ID card. In any event, keep your eyes on those train tracks. If we can find the answer to what or where they are transporting, we may save ourselves from a fate unknown, as there is no reason for the kind of clandestine activity that does not bode well for the common citizen. Now, here's what another guy answered, and he says, they are practicing for the big roundup. A lot of the passenger trains have manacles built into them. They used to have these trains stored in El Reno, Oklahoma. They also had them basically stored and still do at what's called the Gunderson train yards, I believe, outside of Portland, Oregon. Aren't you so happy now to have voted for Bush and his Gestapo? Now, that's what, these are all posts. Listen to this. This is somebody from I thought it said Alaska. That's not it. It's someone else who lives in Montana. Wow, you've seen them too? Been trying to figure it out. First time I thought, though, they were shipping stuff for the war, but then realized that these trains are going east to the Washington coast, I was kind of hoping it was, Nacera rounding up the Black Forces. By the way, Nacera is a bunch of joke. That is not a real thing, everyone. And I get emails talking about Nacera. Get real. It doesn't exist. This other person says this. Forward Observer, this is Melody. I paid a lot of attention to the weird plans afoot, yet somehow I have not seen any mention of these strange night trains. I know about the trains with manacles in them, and I've researched the concentration camps, of which there are hundreds. I wonder if these are practice runs. Somehow I doubt it. People have been running trains for a long time, so they must have a good idea of what to do. My suspicion is that the trains are actually carrying a cargo. And ladies and gentlemen, it's important for you to understand that, again, Helena, Montana is where we have a pretty big military base, Fort Harrison. It's also where the VA hospital is. But in a place called Pipestone Pass, which is between Bozeman and Butte, Montana, it's kind of a unique geological area just because of the humongous boulders. That's been one of the areas that has always been reported, even in, I think, Richard Souter's book, Underground Tunnels and Bases, as being an underground base. Also, the Kookanoosa, I talked to you about that last week when I went up to northern Montana to look at the reservoir levels in the Kookanoosa. The Kookanoosa Railroad Tunnel is supposedly another situation where within that tunnel there are split tracks and there are massive bays, and that's where a lot of people are. Now, ladies and gentlemen, I can tell you point blank that this is not crazy talk. There are seriously hundreds of bases that have already been set up for prison camps. When Al Cuppet and myself were doing talk radio, what, 5, 6, 7 years ago, talking about the red list, the blue list, and the green list, let me make this clear to everyone. The red list in those days had 3.6 million people on it. The blue list had 2.2 million, and the green list had a couple million. But the red list were the people that they absolutely would take out in the first days of any event. Those were comprised of gun owners, of dissenters, of people who had written politically incorrect columns, people who had criticized the New World Order, and it goes on and on and on. Now, the question I want to ask you tonight, for those of you that are aware, and I'm not going to argue the existence of them, believe me, they exist. We have a link on my website to all of the underground bases and tunnels, and there are people who are monitoring those. But the question I have tonight for you to consider, let's say we have multiple terrorist attacks, and these are questions I kick around, and some of you have said you enjoy it when I brainstorm on the air, and tonight, trust me, my storm is a thunderstorm. My brain is in full lightning mode. But what we're trying to get at is how many events and where would the events have to take place to trigger the roundup? Now, I can tell you point blank that there will be a civil war in this country. Whether you believe Dmitry Duderman or not, that's of no consequence to me. Prior to Dmitry Duderman ever coming on the scene, it was always the plan of the Soviets under their Cold War policies, of which Oleg Kalugin, when he defected, told at length the policies was to create a civil war in this country. Whether they're going to do it on racial lines, economic lines, I think now it'll be on religious lines. It'll be Islam, and they'll make sure that radical Islam is fully enforced when they start to initiate the different protocols for rounding up people. Now, let me share this with you. Let's say I'm a New World Order sniper, and I know that all I have to do is take out one guy from the radical jihad side and one guy from the conservative trumpet blower side, and then I plant the evidence to make it look like, you know, we were responsible for theirs and they were responsible for our death. Then do you see how this can escalate? And ladies and gentlemen, I'm telling you, it's already escalating. I've gotten some emails that I will not read on the air, and just for multiple reasons, but they're so specific and so threatening that, quite candidly, I do not have peace in my spirit to read them on the air. I'm not talking about personal death threats. I'm talking about people saying how it's going to come down. And so what I'm sharing with you tonight is that with all these people seeing the trains going through this part of the country, we have more than our fair share of underground bases in the United States. First of all, you've got to understand something. Malmstrom Air Force Base outside of North Dakota and a few other states is probably one of the biggest, intercontinental ballistic missile bases, but it's also one of the most literally spread out military bases in the world with maximum silos, and it's stated that from one silo you can get to another, from one command center you can get to another. Again, I've already stated that. So the point that I'm trying to get everyone to recognize is that if the trains are starting to move now and people are seeing it, and multiple people are witnessing this, and by the way, I have a friend in Casper, Wyoming, who has stated the same thing, and these guys are sophisticated and have night vision, and they said, sure enough, you can see the green glow on the faces. It's important that, I read this next one to you, because this is from someone called Forward Observer. Fellow Montanans, this was in the Bozeman area. We are in the process of setting up a radio relay of Hammond CB operators heading west from Bozeman through the Trident, Tustin, Helena section of tracks. The trains always head west, and the next time they go by, we'll have them trackable as far as Helena if we can get set up quick enough. We may not get that forever. One report from last night stated that in the area the choppers were below the 500-foot FAA limit and were there until just before dawn. And so if this is true, then the area involved must either be a way station or the end of a track. If it is, Americans have got big problems. Now, ladies and gentlemen, I can't validate or verify what I'm going to tell you, but I am told that there are literally mountain doors that open up, kind of like the Swiss do. The Swiss don't have aircraft carriers. They have aircraft mounts. And they have hydraulic doors that open up that are absolutely camouflaged. You cannot see them. And my suggestion is that if these guys are flying this low, they're using their FLIR, F-L-I-R, FLIR units, which is forward-looking infrared, like radar, to pick up people. So they're watching whoever might be tracking them or making sure that no one does. Now, again, it's fascinating because when we get down to this part, it says this, just now, this is where it really got my, attention. Just last week, the Trident, a Swiss-owned cement plant, which is a stop just before the spur we are talking about, announced that their permit to burn tires for other disposable companies in their large spoke stack had passed a major hoop needed to begin operations. Furthermore, unmarked blue trucks painted with the same blue paint used by the local railroad trucks and outfitted with the type of ventilation screens used in paddy wagons have been repeatedly sighted sitting just before dark at the Trident crew change crossing all through this winter. It is confirmed, however, that these are not the crew change wagons that are normally seen by the locals. So the question is, who are these transports for and why? Do you understand what this is really suggesting? That already people are being taken to some of these underground facilities. Who? No one knows. Where are they coming from? No one knows. But again, it's important that you follow this train of thought because this is really a well-developed link. Next clue. The previous fall and summer, local fish, wildlife, and park trucks have been reportedly sighted carrying massive trailer loads of wooden beams in the area, which was odd as the local fishing access had been closed to the public, and they had no sites that included buildings that would require such beams. Also, no one recognized the drivers as any of the known fish, wildlife, and parks folks that we usually see. Now, they are sighted by the locals there everywhere, almost every day, watching but not approaching all of the activities of the local residents. So the hypothesis has emerged. It is speculated that a new cavern excavation was done by those fake FWP Fish, Wildlife, Parks personnel to house something, a space that required large timber shoring. Then the first night trains, which were reported as well-lighted and escorted, with spotlights presumably watched for runners or attackers, were rotated in. They used trains with no more than five boxcars or passenger cars, which probably have carried in the main material and forced labor to build the finished project. Now that it is ready, the lights are out on the trains as they transport in the subjects to be interrogated or experimented on or quarantined. Then when there are deaths, the bodies will be shipped the 5 miles back down to the Trident plant for disposal. This scenario fits other facts. To ascertain which direction it takes as the radio relay is setting up for one possibility, and I won't read any more to compromise anything. But again, here's the thing. It's not just in Montana this is taking place. It's other parts of the country, too. And one of the things that I think is so astonishing and strange to me is many people who have listened to talk radio, whether you've listened to Alex Jones talking about all the New World Order stuff, and he's done, you know, just a fabulous job of tracking a lot of this stuff, and then all of the foreigners involved in this country, and the red list. For the record, the gentleman that gave me the whole issue of the red list, the blue list, and the green list was a high-ranking federal official who I believe was murdered. I have not heard from him for a number of years. He said if I didn't, he said, I'll tell you, they have gotten to me. One of the other things he talked about were all of the ETA portable incinerators. He said, Steve, the 18-wheel incinerators aren't for toxic waste dumps or for toxic people. And what he meant by toxic people are the people that at some point that are going to be dying by literally tens of thousands, and they're going to burn them, cremate them. In other words, keep them rolling, keep those crematoriums rolling. This is so astonishing. I understand it's out there. I understand that some people cannot embrace this. But for your information, it appears that there's a lot of activity once again headed to the camps. And this is something that a lot of people just simply can't put into perspective because they've lost all ability to even recognize the truth. And therefore, as long as they're warm and cuddly and the beer runs, the sports play on, and the rock and roll is on MTV, I guess everything is fine. Now, again, it's a very telling story, and I believe it leaves a lot of question marks that can be answered by the obvious response. Now, I'm going to go to your emails And again, I don't know if any of you are choosing to comment on the subject, but I can share with you point blank that there are people that have talked to a foreign military who've talked about this too, and the foreign military have kind of laughed. And you know, it's amazing. When anybody from outside the U.S. thinks of Americans, they ask how we can be so dumb not to see what's going on. And I must admit to you, that's a good question. Because to a rational outsider, they don't understand how we can believe the amount of horse manure that we believe. And again, it's really important that you understand that this is real stuff, everyone. It's real stuff. Let's see this. Let's see what this says, Guns. Here's what Shirley says. Steve, I've always assumed that guns would be confiscated in order to bring in martial law. What scenario do you see happening since most of us still have guns? How can they accomplish their goals, or will we willingly give them up? I got to share this with you. A very, very brave Christian, how do I say this? A man of God, a high-ranking military guy, said, Steve, and I think I read it on the air a couple months ago, they're going to starve people into submission. And not only will they starve them into submission, the point is, ladies and gentlemen, it's going to be very difficult for most...